taxes over 12 years, you're coming out about $1.4 million ahead for area N1. Now let's contrast that with, I think the most stark example here is going to be area S1. S1 is the opposite end of Highway 181 across the creek. And what we see there is a, we see that it is inside our water service area. We would need to make water improvements to be able to serve that area. It is also within our sewer service area. We would need to make sewer improvements, and we would need to make street improvements in that area, in that area as well. So by the time you take all those capital projects into account and you run it through the model, you find you're coming out about $800,000 in the red in that first 12 years. So that doesn't mean that in year 13, 14, 15, and beyond, that once you made that investment, that things stabilize and you may see some improvement. But it's also 12 years out, projecting 12 years out is enough of a kind of a look into the crystal ball as I would feel comfortable making. This point. So that's an example of an area that's not going to serve very well. If you refer to table one in my summary letter, however, what you see is that combined, if you were to take all of these and all of these areas in under the annexation plan, that you would still come out ahead. It just means that you're focusing some capital improvements intensively in some areas, and others you really just don't have that obligation because the services are already there. That's the reality of it. And that's kind of the reason why we've been talking about going ahead and doing these annexations, is because a lot of these areas already do have services. There's a whole subset of these areas that are agricultural and have agricultural exemptions like this amendment property. And for those, what we've been doing is we've been offering the non-annexation agreements. So I factored that into this economics too. I factored in that assuming that they agree to the non-annexation agreements, and so we're not actually annexed. And that's what happens with the agreements. You don't get annexed. The agreement if you have an annex. So, kind of to summarize, I think what you guys have here is an option. At this point, because we initiated the process based on this set of properties, based on these 10 areas, we've initiated it like that and done the notice that way. We can't go back and add anything to it without starting the whole process over. Can't add any areas. But you do have the ability, because you have better information now, you have some idea of what areas are more profitable than others. You have the ability to confidently say, I think we can postpone annexation on this area or that area, or you can say, because all together combined, you're still coming out $1 million ahead. You can leave everything intact. The question of subsidy, the idea that some parts of the city are paying more to help other parts of the city, that's kind of the nature of the beast when you live in the city. You are always constantly, in some way, subsidizing something that your neighbor benefits from, and vice versa. And that's part of living in the community, that's part of being in the city. So I just want y'all to consider that. I would recommend that if you do want to strike some of these from the plan, that we don't do it based on individual properties, because I think that really cuts into some of the fairness questions. I don't think are a good direction for the council to take. I think rather than do that, look at each area, look at the 10 areas that we've identified and understand how those function as a unit and say, okay, we can do without this one right now. We'll pick it up next round with our annexation. If that's the direction they go in. But kind of gone over a whole bunch of numbers and assumptions. I'll try to outline as best I can in the memo. I'm anticipating that y'all will have some questions. I'm happy to go over it in any amount of detail.
Okay, but what?
Could you put your right down, please?
I said, by when do you need a COPUC answer for what's going to happen? You know, for adding or taking, striking
we
off?
We can strike them up until the end of our period, which is September of next year. So we have until that time to say no.
Okay, so what are you asking of us right now?
Councilman, one of the conversations, I believe Councilman Johns talked about moving some areas, and I think the questions that Councilman Neeson had was the value and how much it cost and those kind of things. And so staff was tasked to have those numbers to come back to you. That's what you were looking for, Councilman? To say what the cost was, what it cost for the infrastructure. I know streets was a big question. And so.
And what would be the return?
What would be returning 12 years? And so that's what your consultant has put together for you. Again, I'll reiterate that it's on the agenda for an action if you care to.
So right now, if we wish, we could strike off one or two properties and then come back before September, add or subtract.
Well, the problem with you doing it, piece one like that, you're not getting into some problems when we have to have a public hearing, kind of like destroys the integrity. You can say, we defined it already, and now you can say, here's our redefinition that we had to do before September of 2018, but you don't want to do it piecemeal.
So in other words, you're trying to tell me that we have to do it all right now?
No, sir. That's what I'm saying. What I'm saying is we wanted to give you information so that you all can make a comprehensive discussion. It's on the agenda to take action if you care to, or you can table it again based on the information you have and come back another time to say if you want to have, you know, redesign it what you've had a chance to. Absorb what he sent to you, but you do not have to make an action tonight. But staff are just recommending that we just don't pick and choose, and once we change it, and that's the new definition, because if you start doing that, we get into some trouble.
My recommendation is, number one, don't strike individual properties. If you're looking to look at an area that doesn't make sense.
That's what we're talking about, areas.
My other recommendation, too, is if you're not sure, then don't strike it because you can't add it back later. Okay? Because once it's struck, then we can't add it back.
But what I'm saying is, if there's two properties that we want to strike right now, we still have until September to do discussion.
Yes, sir. You can.
For the rest.
You can strike these areas at any point leading up to.
But we can't add them. We cannot add them back.
We cannot add them back. That's
correct. Will you explain the worst one, S1, for $881,000 it's going to cost us to annex? Are we going to lose money when we annex? When you go over to capital expense requirement, and that's how much it's going to cost us to improve it, to bring it to the city standards? Explain what the red is.
Mr. Stewart, if I might add on top of that, if you could explain for the citizens in attendance what S1 is in general terms.
Okay, so S1 is an area just the other side of, what is it, Avila Creek, along 181. It's the area with,
towards the 7th Avenue.
Is that both sides? Yes.
On both sides, yes, ma'am.
That's considered, this one is considered both sides.
Yeah.
And then, if you can have a large amount, then you can try to point it to the audience, thank the council.
This area, this one is this blue area down there. Going out of town, going towards Carson.
Green area.
The blue area.
Uh-huh. It's actually the old one.
Great.
Okay, your math. I told you about the wrong last one.
Why is there a crescent cut out? Why is that property just immediately to the west not included?
That is, that's the creek that runs by there.
That's the creek, but, okay.
The thought was, we don't want to annex more than is strategically necessary to lock in that gateway. That's a gateway from our land use.
How much would it cost to put those pumping stations in? On both sides?
So what I did, so that's the area. Make sure everybody's clear on where we're talking about.
Okay, you're saying on both sides of business 181?
Councilman Jimenez, Councilman Missen have a question.
Explain the red numbers of 881.
But he was talking about property.
Wait, I asked him to clarify the location.
Okay.
I still don't know the location. That's my answer.
It's right where Fajardo Creek is.
The green one.
Yes.
The green.
On both sides.
On both sides of 181, that's my question.
Yeah.
Okay, now I know. I know.
Okay. And if you look in here, we've got.
Yeah, no, I understand. I didn't know if you're talking just on one side of 181 or both sides.
Both sides.
Both sides.
Okay. So how did I come up with, why do I have red numbers for that, right? That's the question. Well, we look at a series of expenses from 2017 through 2029, and a series of revenues from 2017 to 2029. In 2019, for example, we're going to need $318,000 in capital expense related to water service. Okay. In 2020, we're going to need $500,000 related to sewer service. And then in the next year, we're going to need another $500,000 for street improvements in that neighborhood. To bring those streets are not very close to city standards. So
$1.5 million. Well, that's the 1.3. That's going towards public.
That's right.
We know it is.
So you have those capital expenses. They're not all happening in the same year, because we have to assume that we're able to phase it in. All right. And then, but at the same time, we're getting in some revenues in terms of ad valorem property tax. We're getting some revenues in. So by the time you factor that out over the 12-year time horizon, those revenues, those expenses, the net revenue to the city is actually a net expense. And we discounted that by 6%, which is a very conservative discount rate, in order to account for, to take a number or a set of numbers that we're looking out 12 years for and bring them back to something we can understand in today's time.
So at the end of 12 years, we will have lost $881,000 by annexing that piece of property.
If you annex just that area and not anything else in the annexation plan, you would lose $880,000.
And how many years? That's a three-year process?
It's a 12-year horizon I'm looking at, but it's a three-year process to get those improvements into place.
Well, like right now, we wouldn't be getting no water revenue from those because they already have a different water company.
We do provide water service for them, even though they're not in the city. They are part of our water service company. They do come right now. Not all of it, but the majority of it is.
Councilman McKenzie was next.
Did you count that in? That's what I was going to ask.
I did not include the water revenue because we're receiving some revenue already from it. So I felt it was more conservative to not include it, because that's actually going to go down, because they're going to start paying in city limits.
They're out of city limit now, and so because they're out of the city, they pay double rates. And so he didn't include that, because once we come in the city, you know, half that, we already receive that revenue. So it's kind of like an in and out.
Yeah, but you got to include the revenue anyway.
Well, just the revenue, just additional revenue for water. So there's no additional water revenue. There will be some additional ad valorem taxes, and of course, another question was the population, so how many people is populated, so it will affect the population as well.
So what's the population in that section?
300.
350 by the end of 2020.
Okay, I see it now.
Now, with you say we're going to have $1.3 million in expenses on water, is that an improvement, or is that at housing? We've already got water out there, we've already got some septic tanks out there. So how do you get that we'll be adding more water expenses?
We've got to come with at least an 8-inch line across the creek, and then to the edge of the city limit. So that extension plus the creek crossing and fire hydrants, redoing the service connections.
Roads and meters.
And appurtenances, yes. And that's an estimate. That's a kind of a best guess based on the linear footage. That's where I live.
You're not figuring in any drainage or anything, even, are you? A lot of that property, there's major things, floors will be taken off for water flow, water drainage.
Yeah, so the unit price for the unit price for the street improvements includes some handling of drainage, so not a major drainage improvement project.
That's a creek, you know.
There's just a lot of things.
So yeah, there may be some.
So you're suggesting if we said, I have no earthly idea who lives here, I don't know property one out there. Do not take the right side of 181, eliminate the whole S1 section. If we take the right side of 181, what's the left side going to say? So your suggestion is eliminate that block or postpone it for a year, or if you decide to postpone it. Just don't take two or three. I don't know if there's 20 lots out there, 10 lots out there, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 lots out there on the right side. Just don't drop them.
Don't drop three lots and keep the others.
Just take the whole section and drop.
Just take the whole section, because we're trying to avoid it being, we don't want it to be a political question. It's not a question of who influenced their council member the most, or who knows who about who owns what property. That's not the question. The question is, these properties kind of function together as a unit. They function together as a unit for us from land use perspective.
Yeah, but it wouldn't be, because the right side, you'd have to run sewer system on west side of 181, and the other side would have to run the sewer system.
If you don't do anything on the right side of the creek, you pick that side of the creek not to do anything. We already got what we needed on the left side.
Well, so, I understand. You know, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
That's what I said.
Now, would it be in the best interest to pick whoever's in the audience? I'm just getting questions. When you look at numbers, if you eliminate S1 and E1, this big expense, I mean E2 and S1, that's our biggest expense. We would increase our positive side.
Yeah, then overall, the package goes up.
One of the things that happened when we started this process with the annexation, when we looked at the map, is that we had some issues, and I'm not saying this is happening with the two areas that we're speaking to, but we just need to be mindful when we're talking about the whole section, is because it kind of hops in and out. And so we need to have more of a comprehensive, and Mr. Stewart is did help us create the best use of the land use and best money. And so when we had issues like on one side of McDonald's is in the city of Floyd, McDonald's is not in the city, but the property right next door is. So that's why we definitely want to start that parcel of in and out, jumping in and out, and people don't realize that.
Yeah, E2 would be a bad example.
So that's what he's, that's why he's saying that, you know, to be contiguous. Thank you.
W1 part is 981 negative to bring it on.
I'm sorry, sir.
The W1 part depends.
Yeah, the W1, that one, I wrestled with that one because that one has a lot of, it's about half, almost half are ag exempt.
That's going down 97 before it's not there?
No.
The W1 side.
That's right there, Windcrest.
That's where houses, a lot of houses would be. That, there's no ag request in their court here, man. W1.
The W1?
No. Why is that so expensive? We already have sewer lines and water lines connecting that system.
There's a lot of empty property.
I know, but that property could be, you know, right now it's getting.
Okay.
So see, this is a misleading thing to me, like I see what Mr. Gerard is saying. We don't have water lines, we don't have sewer lines because it's vacant. But as soon as we start building houses, that's going to offset your numbers tremendously because that is an area that we can build houses on quite a bit. That would offset revenue. But if we basically just put in, yes, I see what you're saying. You're going to have to put in sewer lines, you're going to have to put in some roads.
But they're there.
Well, I don't know that.
But yeah, that's, and that, let's look at that example in detail. Okay, the W1 example, because that's a good one. So what we see with W1 is we have some water improvements. And in fact, let's look at this. Yeah, about 900 foot, linear foot of water line improvements. Okay. We don't have sewer capital improvements because there's sewer line running through there already. We do have street improvements because the road is a dirt road and would need to at least be brought up to a minimum standard. So we do have...
there's only two roads right there. I mean, they're already there. I mean...
But they're dirt. There's 900, and what I figured was 950 linear feet of roadway. So we have water, some water expense. We have $84,000 in water expense, $100,000 in street expense.
That's not new. 881,000, what do you have?
881, which is, no, 981.
981.
It looks like one of the net position losses and administrative and public safety expenses.
Yep. But no, that's not in the highway.
Once we give that is good land to develop for homes, that's going to offset your numbers by quite a bit, because right now there's no homes, there's no ad valorem tax coming in for your model, and if we get ad valorem tax coming in, that's going to really offset that 981,000. That's going to probably be, I don't know what property you can compare it to.
So the other thing going on here too is with the ag exempt properties in that area. They are significant areas. There's a significant area. It's a small number of properties, but it's a significant area. So those properties would not be transitioning to residential use. So they're not bringing any economic benefit to us. We have some in there that is, but
we don't run the water and sewer down to them either.
No. We don't, but we would need to for those that that are developing and those that are smaller tract and that are not ag exempt. We would need to. There, that's it's. You've got. That's why I said it's pieces, lots of different pieces moving in different directions. And what we did is take a snapshot of what happens in this area over the next 12 years.
I would like to make a motion.
No, this is a presentation.
My short presentation.
I need to ask you, how about W2, which is Devlin 536?
Yeah.
That's a flooded?
Yeah,
flood zone area.
I mean, there's no nothing there, so why do we have to annex that?
Well,
Why would you recommend adding scene depth?
I recommended putting it in the plan. There are four properties in there. Each of the four properties is ag exempt. See, that is one of those properties. Okay? So if we assume that that they all accept the agreement, then it doesn't become annexed. But we leave it in the plan just in case somebody decides, nah, I don't want to do the agreement, because then we've lost our opportunity to take.
But you said we could come back a few years later.
We could.
Okay. So for right now, it's not feasible to do that.
An annexation, how much money has it cost us? Ballpark figure, guess, has it cost to get this far in 2 years?
We've been working this for about 2 years, and this is phase two of our annexation plan. The first phase actually completed this parcel here, and then going out towards the Richardson's to get them in. That was the phase one. This we spent probably about somewhere between $60,000 to $75,000 today to do all the public hearings and the engineering and the cost for the consultant as well as the cost for legal. But I believe the county recommended they wanted us to go to river. The county wanted us to be able to include that. Now, when the first annexation plan, we had I think Mr. Smith probably sticks out of my mind, and another. But they had against this agreement that's all to 45 years. That's as much as you can do. They did the whole 45 years. And so in this set, we wanted, I believe we're doing 42 years so that they can all come out together and 42 years from now to all come out. So what it means for agricultural is that they get to keep ag, they get to stay ag. If they don't make any changes or do any commercials, they get to stay. But we get to count their acreage in us when we're able to do that, because we can only annex 10% of our size every year. That's why this is approximately a little under 38%. Now, I just read the paper last week, I believe it was most good news, that actually Elmendorf is looking at doing an annexation plan. So we need to have a plan in reference to do that. And so we need to have an approach. And so if you opt to take out certain sections, we'll complete this process, hopefully in 2019, and then you can decide what you want to do going forward. But we need to make ourselves holistic to go forward. They just made some changes, I believe the legislature made some changes in September 1 in reference to the size, but we are underneath that because they did it according to your county size. And so if you're going to do this, this may be your only opportunity, because by the time we're finished, they may change the laws in order to do that. And I think they're addressing that, you know, consulting themselves to be better because of what San Antonio is doing. And so we're going through all this process. And that's why the 3 years are there, because once you annex them, you have to have a plan to be able to say how we're going to provide services. Because I'm in a new annex area, I just was ready, but in Japan since the beginning of Floresville. And so you have to be able to provide them with services that are reasonable. It has to be reasonable. And so we have a consultant in place that can tell us what is reasonable. But if you look at the map and then behind each, I know it's a whole lot, you'll have the tree. But if you look at the map itself and then under behind it is each detail of what that dollar amount goes through and what it stands for.
You know, whenever, I guess what would be more feasible is do business with 181, wherever, I mean, 181, Highway 181 is where you're going to gain more revenue, and then later on annex the rest of the other stuff that we could probably afford, you know, after making that type of revenue.
Staff's recommendation, and I can't speak for you, so the staff recommendation is that if you can't remove anything from it, it needs to be in this section that we have that makes sense in reference to the plan. You don't want to cherry pick. And it's definitely
but up to I'm just saying the areas, whatever we're going to do, I mean, we're going this way. So
you can select whatever you like. Councilman Johnson, I can ask, did he address the section that you were concerned about?
Up Rio Creek towards the Culver's, another one was from Bluebonnet Street.
The one
on
97, which one is that?
E1.
E1.
E2 would be the one next to the church, not on Bluebonnet.
Yes, it's all Bluebonnet. The church is already in city.
Yes, it'd be for the church, Catholic Women's Church. Yes, it is already in St. Louis.
What they're wanting to annex is from Blue Bonnet out towards the shoreline. You know, most of that is state owned, the highway department there, the shoreline is tax exempt. But what they're trying to annex, 707